The Azure Time Series Insights is not just good at storing timestamp data, it actually does way more. And Deepak from the TSI team comes here to tell us all about the model and query that Time Series Insights offer. Thanks for watching the IoT Show. I'm Olivier, your host. Today with Deepak, we're going to talk about Time Series Insights, IoT data flow, query and model, and all of the things that make TSI super interesting for building IoT applications. Deepak, thanks for coming to the show.
Thanks, Olivier, for having me on the show. Hello, everyone. My name is Deepak Palade. I'm a program manager from Time Series Insights program management team. Today, I'm super excited to be here to walk you guys through, you know, what is the regular IoT data flow, what happens in model, what happens in query within TSI, and all the goodness that we have to offer to our customers.
Awesome. As an introduction, I want to do some provocation here. I'm getting asked a lot of time, actually, when talking about Time Series Insights. Why would I go to Time Series Insights when I'm building an IoT solution? So why?
So thanks, Olivia, for the question. Chandrika, when she was on the show, she spoke about all the goodness that we have to offer as part of TSI Pay-as-you-go, which is our next version of the product. And Rahul, I think he spoke about all the analytic features that are available in our Explorer already as we build this product and move towards GA. Today, I want to focus more on contextualization and why we differentiate by providing contextualization within our product so that customers can make it easy for them to go and say, hey, how can I explore the data in a seamless fashion?
Got it.
So I think, you know, that plus, in addition to that, you know, the querying capabilities differentiate us.
So let's talk about this superpower of TSI in the context of the data flow, typical data flow for IoT scenarios, right?
Correct. So IoT data flow involves a couple of steps which are common across all the platforms. You first collect the data, you then process the data, you store the data, and then you analyze the data. As part of processing the data, you try to contextualize that. That way, the data stream that is coming in from the device is not sparse. It has some meaning to it, so that when you try to explore the data, you can correlate that easily. Yeah. So time series model actually helps customers in doing that in a more simplified fashion.
Can you give us an example? So like data coming from a sensor, and why would you need to have that context added to it as metadata or a model, right? So a concrete example of that.
Yeah, I mean, there are multiple reasons why you need to go and contextualize data. One of that is to make it easy to explore, easy to understand, and easy to correlate. Like for example, right, if a sensor is sending temperature values, if you just have a timestamp and a value for temperature, yes, it adds value just for the temperature perspective, but if you want to correlate that with, hey, when temperature was down, what was the effect on the pressure sensor that is in the same room? Hey, when there was like a lot of occupancy within the room, what contributed to the temperature sensor and how it worked? So when you want to do all of these type of computations or analysis, adding context to your telemetry becomes key.
Okay. So Time Series Insight, as this notion of model, allows you to contextualize the data, right? So tell us a bit more about this model for Time Series Insights and how it's used.
Yeah. Time Series models essentially help our customers to go and contextualize the telemetry that is coming in, wherein, you know, it is a semantic model for the data that is being, you know, stored in TSI, where, you know, they can come and specify the properties that are associated with the telemetry stream that is coming in. As well as we use a time series model to specify the hierarchies, where, hey, how can we make exploration easy for our customers so that when they go to our Explorer and they start exploring all the instances that are available, it is easy for them to find it. And the third thing and the most important thing that time series model does is enabling our customers to do computations. So we have this notion of types within TSI, which actually hosts variables. In variables, you know, customers can use various different scalar and aggregate functions to go and provide the computation. So as part of this demo, I'll be walking through, you know, what does that look like and what is, you know, our scripting language and how easy it is to go and manage that.
So before you jump into it, you know, showing us a bit more about what these variables and types are looking like, I think a valid question is going to come is, how does it tie into IoT PlugandPlay, which is this new feature that will allow devices to auto-declare the capabilities? So a device would send telemetry, but also like would share its model from the IoT PnP perspective, so that the cloud solution would know what to do with them. So is TSI, you know, part of that PnP story?
Completely and fully. We will be deeply integrating with Plug and Play. As we speak, the integration is happening. And sometime soon, you know, you'll hear more from us on when we can do a preview of that. Mm-hmm. But essentially, this is how it will work. So Plug and Play enabled devices will send device discovery to Hub. Mm-hmm. So anyone, you know, who actually subscribe to that can actually determine what telemetry is being sent to the Hub. Mm-hmm. So in TSI, within the model, we have something called as instance discovery, right, which actually discovers the instance of a device. Mm-hmm. So what our aspiration is to connect that with device discovery. That way, whenever there is a new device that is connected to our Azure IoT ecosystem, mm-hmm, if a customer has a TSI provisioned, then we automatically discover that to understand, oh, there is a new device that is online, mm-hmm, and we quickly use that signal to go back to the Hub and get the interface details to determine what all are the additional context information that are available for that in our model repository, and then sync that with TSM. So we will be natively integrating these. That way, the instance, mm-hmm, the instance fields, which are your properties, plus types, which hold your computations, are automatically populated for our customers. So that is the aspirations of the North Star.
And it feels it's going to be super automatic. But before we jump into that automatic way of getting the model, show us a bit more about what is that model looking like in TSI, and how do you create it? How do you associate data streams to that model right now?
Yeah, so if you look at the if you look at this diagram here, mm-hmm, it speaks about all the benefits of the model. Okay, yep. It is a semantic model, it contextualizes it, mm-hmm, it is easy to use, wherein, you know, you can use our public surface APIs, or you can use, you know, our Explorer, mm-hmm, to natively go and edit the model. And then, you know, it enables computation. So we have this instance discovery that I referred to, mm-hmm, which will continuously, you know, be listening to the IoT Hub. Mm-hmm. And whenever there is a new device that comes in there, we just create that instance within our Explorer. And when we jump to the Explorer, I'll give you a simple example of that. And then, you know, customers specify hierarchies, which is parent-child relationship, mm-hmm, using those instance fields. And then, you know, they go and create a type in which they specify all the computation. Okay. And type is the most important thing out of everything, if you ask me, because that is where what you do with the data, mm-hmm, comes into play. So think about types as classification of all the sensors, where, you know, if you have all the temperature sensors in building 40, then you can just take all the sensors and assign that to a type and then create computation on that type. Mm-hmm. That way, when you come to our Explorer, you can natively explore that type, mm-hmm, and the variables within that type. Variables is where we have the computation. Like, you know, if you look at, you know, any variable definition, in variable definition has a kind, it talks about the type of telemetry that you are analyzing. It can be either a continuous telemetry, mm-hmm, or a discrete telemetry. Like, you know, numeric variable is continuous telemetry, categorical variable is a discrete telemetry. Like, discrete telemetry can be, hey, is the sense, is the wall on or off? Mm-hmm. And continuous telemetry will be, hey, what is the pressure every minute or every 30 seconds? What is the temperature every minute, every 30 seconds? So customer can use the notion of kind to specify that. And then comes the value element within, mm-hmm, you know, variable, where we talk about what is the property that it is referring to. Then comes the filter clause, where you can say, hey, while computing, just compute where the status is good. Mm-hmm. I don't worry about all the bad elements for this computation. Yeah. So you can use, you know, filter to essentially go and do that. Mm-hmm. Then comes interpolation. So this is where, you know, we are introducing this notion of signal reconstruction, where, let's say, you know, you have a device sending data. All of a sudden you realized, oh, you know what, for this time period, there is no data there. Then you can use the notion of interpolation, which is essentially signal reconstruction, to go and look at your left or right and reconstruct what could have been the possible value here. So that is what we are planning to enable through interpolation. And finally, we have aggregate on, hey, I got all of this data points within an interval. How can I reduce that into one? How can I reduce multiple data points into a single point? So the notion of all of this is stored in variable. So the advantage that our customer get with this is, when there are a lot of solutions which actually pre-compute the data and they store the pre-computed values within their store. But in our case, what we do, we store raw telemetry that is coming in. And at exploration time, we use the notion of variable to project out what is required to be visualized.
Got it. So it's not like you're actually overloading or destroying or reducing the data. You're basically enriching it with a new set of data based on this model.
Correct. So we just maintain the source of truth as is without, you know, doing any pre-calculation on that. But on the fly, you know, model enables us to go and compute that.
Got it. So now you have stuff stored, right?
Yes.
And so to access that stuff stored, you need queries.
Yes.
Okay, so the segue is, how do you access that data?
Yes, so in Time Series Insights, we have a Time Series Query, which enables our customers to go and compute the variables that we stored in model, use those variables, and go and query the data. So in a jest, you know, we have different APIs used to do various different things. So we have some environment APIs, which we use to manage the environment. We have some model APIs, like TSMQ is what we refer to, that time series model query APIs, where you can use those APIs to do CRUD on the model. Itself. And then you have TSQ APIs, which helps you in computation. So we have three APIs as of today. One is aggregate series, the second one is get series, and the third one is get events. These are three core time series query APIs. So aggregate series essentially takes a search span as an input along with time series ID and interval. And then, you know, it tries to calculate a point per interval by using the notion of variable. So you can specify either an inline variable as part of the request, or you can project the variable that is stored in the model. But the goal of aggregate series is essentially take all the data points within an interval and collapse them into a single point. That way it is easy for a customer to analyze billions of data points that are already available. Okay. And then we have this notion of get series. Get series does essentially everything that aggregate series does, but aggregation. It doesn't aggregate it. It helps customer create a new sort of, you know, virtual column, you can say, using the notion of variable, but, you know, it will not aggregate the data. And then we have another API, get events, which is the raw telemetry API. It helps customer to look at data that was recorded as is on the wire.
Love it. So, and what I like here is that we're once again simplifying developers' life, because all what you described, which is part of TSI as a functionality, are things that people are actually developing, or they have to develop, or they're plumbing because they need it. And now basically with TSI, you're giving it to them to have them focus on adding the value, which is really extracting insights out of that telemetry data coming from IoT devices.
Correct, you nailed it. Actually, you know, just to add a little bit of context to that, when we think about our query APIs or our model, we want to be the first and best for Azure IoT, A. B, we want to make it seamless for people to use this. Like, for example, right, we have multi-layered storage. I mean, when Chandrika did her session, she spoke about the multi-layered storage we have. We have cold, we have warm, and in future we'll have hot, where what we want to do with query is we want to abstract out multiple languages that our customer have to go through and learn in order to go and interact with that storage. We want to rationalize that, and we want to have a single querying language. That way, it is easy, A, to understand, B, to query, and C, to integrate that with their line of business applications.
Awesome. I want to see how that looks like in the Explorer in terms of the model, the query. How do you interact with all of that?
Yeah, towards the end of this session, you know, we will send some links around, you know, how can you go and play in our demo environment. But, you know, when you land in a TSI environment, you land on this page where, you know, you have two sections, analyze and model. And I think Rahul covered this. In model is where, you know, the action happens. Instance, for example, are your virtual representation of time series. Essentially, this is where customer, I mean, this is what is sniffed from the wire. Instance discovery creates this. This is where customers will come and add context to the data. They will add, hey, what is the model? I mean, here I'm just looking at Contoso Fleet time series analytics. This is a fleet management company which is trying to use TSI to understand and analyze their fleets. So here you have these static properties or instance fields where they can come and specify the key value pair for this. They can use APIs or our UX to come and specify this. Now this, then, instance fields are used to build hierarchies. Hierarchies, if you say, you know, here I have like hierarchy called delivery truck ops, which is made of country, lease to, manufacturer, year, and make. Now, these values are coming from the instance fields here. So if you see here, it will say, okay, from hierarchy. So we are using this to create that. In future, the key point here is we will be integrating this with ADT. When ADT evolves,
which
we will natively
Azure Digital Twins.
Azure Digital Twins. We will natively integrate this with them. That way, you know, if a customer has an ADT, then we automatically sync that entity relationship or graphs and nodes within our world, and we can help them visualize them in the same semantics that they are aware of.
And it's all making sense.
Totally. We are there.
We do have a grand plan.
Yes, we do have a grand plan. And then, you know, this notion of types that I spoke about. So types, essentially, you know, it has variables. Like, for example, right, there are multiple things you can do with this. Like, for example, let's take these two things, average speed. Average speed is a numeric type, which is a continuous signal. And here, if you see, these all are the properties that are coming on the wire for this device. I will say, hey, I want to speed on this, and I want to do an average of speed. So I can use this, and I can save a variable. Then I can do, hey, now that I have average speed, because this is not continuous data, let me see, you know, wherever the data is missing, let me go and reconstruct the data. For that, I'm using an interpolation clause here. So if you look at, you know, the definition for this, I will go and say, hey, I think it'll be easier if I show it here.
Yep.
Visual Studio Code. So if you see, this is the notion of average speed, where, you know, it is a numeric variable. Mm-hmm. It refers to the speed value. And then I have the same speed calculated using interpolation. I call it interpolated average speed, where, you know, it uses the notion of interpolation, and I tell, hey, I want it to linearly interpolate, and I want, you know, one day as my boundary, where go up to one day to figure out if there is a point and use that to reconstruct this.
Yep.
So that notion. So customers can use, you know, all the computations. They can use advanced scalar functions, regular scalar functions, and they can specify, you know, that computation here. Like, for example, right, you know, if you look at the value field here, I have trigonometric functions. So as of today, TSI supports trigonometric functions, where you can say, I'm looking at, you know, road slope. If you look at any standard definition of road slope, it takes a tan of altitude square divided by longitude square plus latitude square.
I trust you.
Yes, definitely, yeah. So this is one of the examples that we use in order to tell, hey, you know, the trigonometric functions are supported within TSI. Mm-hmm. So you have basic scalar functions that are available, you have advanced scalar functions, and we will be adding even more functions to make our TSQ and TSX, time series expression language, rich, feature rich, that way our customers can go and achieve all the scenarios that they think of.
Yeah.
And then again, you know, you can use the upload JSON. Like, again, you know, you can just select the file, what you just updated, and you can just, you know, upload that, and life is good. So this is where the computations are stored. Now, coming to exploration, analyze type is where we explore the data.
Mm-hmm.
This is where, you know, the rubber meets the road, if you ask me, where we take whatever we have designed in the model. See, model, again, customers can use native TSI to model, or, you know, we will be deriving that from, you know, PNP-enabled ecosystem in future. So that is the grand plan that we have for how to evolve our model. And then what happens when customers actually design that, let's say they want to come here, this is where hierarchy comes into play.
Okay.
If you see here, hey, I had delivery truck ops hierarchy built there. I have country, and I have company, at least two. I have model, I have year, and here, this is where I have the truck. If you see here in our explorer, we can start exploring the variables. Now we created average speed. I can project average speed. We created, you know, interpolation variable. We can use that variable, the notion of that variable in explore. So this is how we know we are making it very simple for our customers to analyze the data.
Got it. And everything you're showing in TSI Explorer, once again, is available through API, so people can actually build their own UI based on the service itself, right?
Correct. Because we have public surface APIs for TSQ and TSM, they can natively integrate this with their line of business application, and, you know, they can do a dual-way conversation with those APIs.
Great. Well, Deepak, great insights into the IT data model and query that actually we have within Azure TSI. So if you want to learn more, you want to play with Azure TSI, there's an AKA link, aka.ms/TSI preview, correct? And if you want to learn more about TSI in general, you go to aka.ms/TSI documentation, in one word.
Yep.
And you'll get to the actual docs and references and so forth that you need to work on for you to become the data analyst that you need to be, right?
Perfect, yes. I couldn't have put it in a better way.
Well, thanks a lot for watching the IoT show, and subscribe to get some more information about IoT in general. Deepak, hope to see you soon.
Thanks, Olivier. Thanks for the opportunity. Hope to see you guys soon.
Bye.